One of my bugbears when it comes to software development is overuse of the word model, because we see the word model used again and again for all sorts of different things which are only vaguely connected. Now, it's understandable because what we're doing when we develop software is we are trying to make a model, a software model, of the real world. So the term does come up a lot, but I think in certain situations we do need to be careful because it can cause confusion. And particularly one place we need to be careful is in the world of MVC alongside entity framework, because the word model is used in those two different technologies for similar but different things. Let's just consider the sort of setup we have. So a typical MVC application will have at the bottom some kind of database, and then we'll have a controller which extracts data from the database using entity framework, and then we'll have the controller sending information to the view to display it as HTML. And the classes that are involved in both of those layers of transfer are often referred to as models. So we have the model classes in Entity Framework representing the data in the database, and then we have the model in MVC, that's what the M stands for, taking data from the controller to the view. And in very, very simple cases, which is what you typically get when you're taking a course or reading a book or something like that, the structure of those two classes will be exactly the same. But very quickly, in any serious application, they will start to diverge. So let's suppose we've got the situation where all we want to do is register a user for login on our site. So in the database, we're going to have a table with, at a bare minimum, two columns, one for the username, one for the password. So the model class representing that table will just have those two properties. But when it comes to the view, we're actually going to have the username plus the password, plus the confirm password. So typically, just in case the user mistypes their password when they're registering, we have that confirmation. So the model that would be taking the data between the view and the controller would actually have three properties. So immediately we can see a situation where there is a difference between those two structures, and it will happen again and again and again. So the terminology that I personally use, and a lot of people use, is this. The model that takes data from the database to the controller, we call the entity model, or in fact, more normally, just the entity. And then the classes that take data from the controller to the view and back, I will simply call those the model classes, because they are the M of MVC, so why change that? So we talk about the model as the MVC part of it, and then the entity as the entity framework part of it. Some people will call the model of MVC the view model to make the distinction, which I think is kind of clear, but the problem is view model is also used in another related design pattern, MVVM, model view view model, and it means something slightly different there. So I don't like to use that term because it can cause a bit of confusion. So we're going to stick with model for MVC, entity for entity frameworks. Now let's take a look at some of the practical upshots of that. So back to our application that we've seen before, and now we can see in this book library, we can be very clear, this book and this author, these are entities. So those are classes representing the data in the database. And at the moment, if we look at our controller, we are also using those as models. Because, for example, if we look at this details, we can see we're getting back a book, and that is of that book type from the book library, so that's the entity, and we're sending that straight through to the view. Works okay, but it doesn't necessarily make a lot of sense. One of the reasons that you'll immediately see our divergence between models and entities is to do a thing known as flattening. So at the moment, if we run this up, we can see that this is the book's index page. We've got the title and the year, but then also, not really part of the book class, we've also got some of the author information. But we're not displaying all of the author information. If you look at the actual structure of our author entity, you can see that as well as the name, we've got a date of birth on there. But we're not interested in that because all we're trying to show is the book and the author name. But if we look at the SQL that's generated, you'll see that it has fetched everything. So it's done the join between book and author, and it has read, for example, the date of birth of the author, even though we didn't really need that. And that's Not going to be a huge overhead, but it is a slight overhead, and it could add up if you've got lots of data that you're not necessarily interested in. So what we want to do is this process of flattening, where we take the combination of the book plus the author as entities and turn it into a single book model that we can display easily on the page. So conveniently, we've already got in our MVC a folder called models. To be honest, quite often in a big application, I will have a whole separate DLL for my models, but here we'll just put them straight into the MVC application. And so what I'm going to do is add a new class, and I'm going to call this book model. So although I call my entities just the name of the thing, like book and author, I could call the model just book because it's in a different namespace, but I find that would get a bit confusing. So I normally call my models model just to make it a bit clearer. So we'll add that. And then the information we want to have in our book model is going to be similar to what we have in the book, but slightly different. So what I'll do actually is I'll pinch some of it. I'm going to take all of that and put it in here. But the big change I'm going to make is I'm not going to have the author as an author. I'm just going to have the author as the name, and so we'll just make that a string. So that's our flattened version. We're going to get the title and year of publication from the book entity. We're going to get the author name from the author entity, but we're going to squish them together into a single class for the model that we present over to the view. Then the next thing we've got to do is obviously transfer that data over from the entities into the model. And one way we could do that, not actually necessarily the best one, but we look at it, is just to do it with a constructor. So we could have a constructor for book model, and we could give that a parameter of type book. So that's book from our book library. Call that entity. And then we could copy over the information. So ID equals entity.id, title equals entity.title, year of publication equals entity.year of publication, and then author equals entity.author.name. So that's got all the data in there. We're of course assuming that we have done the appropriate eager loading so that the book does have an author, but we'll deal with that in the controller. Because in the controller, let's just do this for our index for now. What we've got there, that is our list of books. But if I just in here do a dot select and then B gives new book model, passing in the book. So that will call the constructor for the book, and then we've now got books as a list of book models. What we'll then need to do is delete the old index, because that was the index based on the book entity, and then generate a new one. Still going to be called index, still going to use the list template, but now we're going to have it for book model. So if we just add that, we can see it's just generated the standard list page. If we run it up, and we can see it's listed out the books and the authors, but this time based on that single flat class book model, not the separate book and author. However, if we take a look at the generated SQL, you can see it's still not solved one of those problems. It's still asking for the date of birth of the author, even though we never actually use the date of birth. And the reason it can't work things out properly is because we've hidden away from Entity Framework the bit of the code that decides what parts of author we want. So if we look in there again, we saw our book model had just the need for author.name, but because that was inside the constructor, it can't really be seen, and so all that work has to be done after the data has been loaded from the database. We can get around that. What we need to do, in fact, is in here, we need to do things slightly different. We don't call the book model constructor. We have to initialize everything using property initializers, because those will be visible to the entity framework provider, and therefore it will be able to translate those into SQL. So what I'll need to do back on the book model, I need to give it a default constructor, and then if I take all of that code and just pop it in there, and then obviously we need to change entity to B, and we need to change those semicolons to commas, and that should function in exactly the same way. So we're still getting the same results, but now if we look at the generated SQL, we can see that it hasn't selected the date of birth from the author. The only thing we've got from the author was the author's name. That's because it has been able to look at that in the member initializer and decide precisely what needs to be fetched. And in fact, we can take that one step further because we don't now need to have the include. Because Linked to Entity Framework can see that we want the author's name, it can now work out for itself that we therefore need to pull in at least part of the author and generate the join. So if we run it like that, still works. And still has the efficient query where we're just pulling in the name. So to a large extent, we can forget about using the include to do our eager loading, because if we use this approach, we have an even more precise way of doing it. We are saying not just that we need the author, but precisely that we need the author's name and nothing else. And although it's not a huge saving, if there's a lot of data coming back from the database, reducing that by potentially quite a large amount here would be quite a useful thing to do. There is still a slight downside to it though, which is now our code is rather ugly. If we look over here, there we've got nice encapsulation, nice separation of concerns. The book model knows how to initialize itself. Whereas because we can't use that, now we've got to duplicate that knowledge of how a book model should initialize itself into the controller, which isn't really very nice. And if we're doing this again and again, which we would be in the other methods of the controller, we would have code duplication. So how do we have the best of both worlds? Well, the trick we can do is to use an extension method. So what we can do is in here, put it in the same file because it is so tightly related to the book model class. I'm going to have a public static class called book model extensions. And in there, I'm going to have my public static method. And this is going to return an iQueryable of our book model. I'm simply going to call it toModel. And then the parameter it's going to take, so this is the data type is extending, is going to be iQueryable of the entity book. Okay, and we'll call that source. So what we're doing with this toModel method is defining a way of mapping a collection of book entities onto a collection of book models. What we then need to do is we're going to say return source.select. So you'll notice really it's very similar to what we were doing in there. And then B gives, and in fact, let's just steal all of that because it is that similar. So right down to there, let's take that code and put it into there. So exactly the same code, but we've put it into the file that makes more sense. We've put it alongside book model, not put it in the controller. And then in the controller, all we now need to do is in there, just say toModel. And you'll see it's picked that up because we already had the namespace in there. But books is, although it's a DB set there, it implements iQueryable. So that's our iQueryable of book that we are extending. And then toModel does the work for us. And so now if we run that up, we can see it's still working. And again, we can see that the query is really as efficient as it possibly could be. And then once we've done that, we can start reusing all of that. So let's say go to our details. And the way we do this now is we still need our context.books. We don't need the include. Again, instead, we simply put the to model there. So we put it early on before we do something like the single so that all this work can be done in the database. And then we have our selection. Once again, details previously was using the entity directly. So let's get rid of our details view and replace it with one generated for the model. Details book model, and then get rid of the context, add that, and then let's just go to our index and change the link down the bottom here so that the details is going to work. And so if we run that up and go to details there, so there we can see we've got the information. Again, if we look at the query, we can see that's where it selected the single book. But again, the only bit of information about the author it needed was the author's name. So quite a nice way where we can have reusable code. We can have efficient code because it's optimizing the SQL. And we do that, as we saw there, by creating the model. And then each model, we use an extension method that we can call toModel to convert a collection of entities into a collection of models. The only slight downside that some people have with this kind of approach is when you're doing this bit of the mapping, whether you're doing it there in the constructor or here in the select, it is a bit repetitive because very often you'll find in the majority of cases, the name of the property and the type of the property in the model is the same as the entity. So we're mapping over ID to ID, title to title, year of publication to year of publication. The only one that's a slight difference is it's author.name going to author. And so you could well imagine that that's the sort of task you might want to automate. And in fact, there are a number of libraries available for that. Probably the best known one is one called AutoMapper, which is available through NuGet. So there we can see that's AutoMapper. Lots and lots of downloads. Very popular one. Personally, although I've used AutoMapper, I'm not a fan of it because although it does save you that effort we're talking about here of writing this very repetitive code, the problem is that it can then risk doing things for you that you didn't really want it to do. An example is a situation where I'd been using AutoMapper. Later on, I added a new property that I only wanted to be updated in certain circumstances. So it was a field that wanted to be set when an object was created, but not when it was edited or anything like that. And I spotted that it was being changed, even though I hadn't coded this, when I was doing the edit. And so the first thing I did was a search for this particular property name to see where it was being referenced. Couldn't find hardly anywhere in the code where it was being referenced. And then I realized what had happened was AutoMapper had simply automatically started mapping it, even though I hadn't explicitly told it to. Now, AutoMapper has lots of configuration where we can say, no, don't do it for this particular property or do it in a certain way. But the thing is, if you don't configure it, it does it automatically. Personally, given the small one-off effort up front, I prefer to write my own code to do this. And then if I have to change it, if I need to put a breakpoint, if I need to do a search, then it's all available there for me. But plenty of people like AutoMapper, so I'm not going to tell you not to use it. You can use it just like this in both these ways. So you can use it to generate an efficient SQL query when you're using Entity Framework as well. So that's it. We've looked at the relationship between models and entities, entities relating to Entity Framework, models relating to MVC. We've seen how, although they start out the same, when you get any degree of complexity, they start to diverge. And we've also seen how we can actually use them to really produce efficient queries. We no longer need to worry about eager loading in terms of the include method, because now we can use this really precise targeted loading that only loads what is required in the model, rather than loading everything that the entities may provide. Hope you enjoyed that. If you did, please click on the like button because that helps promote us in the YouTube rankings and therefore more people will get to see the video. And also, of course, do subscribe so you can see all the other videos as well.